connection.
Hi, this is Jasper Kitty, my emotional support kitty, and I am Emily Ross, LPC. I think I'll start this session by saying I definitely need to do one on burnout and fatigue. It's been a 14-hour day now, but I had some great questions, and I really wanted to start to respond to those. So, again, don't forget to subscribe and hit notifications so you get all of this free mental health content. So the question was about what the long-term repercussions of verbal abuse in the workplace might be. And so I think I'm going to have to answer that in two different segments, but I wanted to start off with this one by saying that, or highlighting that the truth is that our amygdala decides what is traumatic to us. So remember the amygdala, I'll show you in the brain. Hold on, Jasper, watch out. The amygdala is this part of the brain, that little tiny green speck, right, that decides, that takes in all the information. So you're hearing my voice, you're feeling the temperature of the room you're in, sensations on your skin, all your five senses are taking in information through your amygdala. And as long as nothing's threatening to your amygdala, it'll go through to your frontal cortex. And that's where you reason and you decide, oh, this video is stupid, I'm going to go off that. Or, oh, I can't wait to hear what Emmy says next. I wonder why her cat's there. That's what decides or says the, lets you formulate responses, right? The minute your amygdala decides something's threatening, it'll cut off communication with that and it'll activate your central nervous system. If you've watched my videos by now, you know that means you get flooded with adrenaline, cortisol, and testosterone, that your heart rate will accelerate, your digestion will slow down, all of the central nervous responses will gear up to help you to defend yourself. And so what your brain decides is threatening is really based on different factors. One is personal experience. So I'm 48, so by now my amygdala has a bar of what it thinks is threatening and not. And so when you have people with chronic trauma, you would think everybody with chronic trauma will respond this way. It's just not that way. So I have chronic trauma, and so my amygdala's bar is so high. I'm going to give you an example, and this is now an infamous story in my family. It's called Not My Beignets. So I went to New Orleans, which if you know me, you know I love New Orleans. I love it there. I also am really bad with money. So I went to New Orleans with my oldest daughter, Jaden, and I had literally $20. So I had to pay for gas there, parking, and I wanted to buy beignets from Café Du Monde. So you buy beignets and you buy a café au lait, or however you say it, and I go up to the Mississippi River and I eat my beignets. So I had bought my beignets and we're up by the Mississippi River and I had no money now because I had literally $20. Now I have no money. So over on the side, there was these three people who were just very obviously intoxicated and they were plotting on stealing my keys, which I had dangling from my belt loop because I would clip them on so I wouldn't lose my keys. And I heard them and I just didn't care. I was having fun eating my beignets. My daughter Jaden was there. And so we're talking and they make their way over and they start to do this very typical, I don't know what you call it. Like, what would you call that, Matthew? You know what I mean about the boots. They have this, it's like all of the crooks get together and they come up with this plan on how to swindle people's money and they all use the same one. So if you go there a lot, you already know it. Like, it's the August where your boots are from. So everybody who's been there are like, yeah, I know that one. So they start doing that, and I literally don't care because I've already, my amygdala has already sent this all to my frontal cortex, and I'll tell you honestly, and you can laugh at me, but this was my thinking. If they can get my keys for me, one, they're wicked intoxicated. If they can get my keys for me, one, and then find my car parked wherever in New Orleans, right, and three, get there before it's booted, and actually steal my car and drive it the however many feet they're going to get this intoxicated, I feel like they deserved the joyride in the Mustang. And so I was literally not worried about it. So they're going on, and my daughter is getting increasingly more agitated. She's watching this whole thing, and her amygdala was not doing what mine was. She was like really starting to get uncomfortable. She stood up, she started to go to the side, and she realized I wasn't doing anything. Well, at one point, the guy leaned forward, because he was tipsy, leaned forward, and I took my beignets, and I leaned back, and I said, not my beignets. And at that point, Jaden lost it. She was like, Mom, what is wrong with you? Can't you see they're trying to rob us? And I was like, she's like, all you care about is your beignets. And I looked at her dead in the face and I was like, well, yeah, I don't have any money to buy more beignets. And she's like, they're going to take your car. And I was like, they're really not going to get my car. Like, they can't even stand up. They're not going to get my keys. So my amygdala had decided that that was not a threat. And you can tell that's true because I was reasoning. Although my reasoning is somewhat flawed, I can give you that. Like, most people wouldn't have thought of it that way. But I was using logic and reason, and to me it made sense, and so I wasn't scared at all. Jaden was literally horrified. She couldn't believe it, and she tolerated it as long as she could until she literally lost it and was like, they're trying to rob us. What are you doing? So her amygdala decided the exact same situation was a threat, and her logic and reason got cut out. And she started to respond with the central nervous system response. She'll tell you, her heart rate was elevated, her blood pressure was through the roof, her senses were heightened. She really had a hard time with that. It was hard for her to settle down afterwards a lot because it just didn't faze me even after that. I tried to explain to her why it didn't matter, but she didn't agree with me. So all that is to say is that, and I got my beignets, you didn't get my beignets. And I got the car because he couldn't get my keys. But at any rate, that's all to say that you don't get to decide on like a conscious level if your amygdala is going to choose something as a threat or not. And so sometimes when people go through chronic trauma, their bar gets set really high. My bar is very high. It takes a lot from my amygdala to believe that my life is in danger because I've been in lots of those situations and lived. So now it has to be real super high for my amygdala to cut off communication and for me to get that central nervous system response. Sometimes when people have chronic trauma, their amygdala gets overactivated, right? So it gets hypervigilant and everything becomes a threatening event. And you don't get to decide that, really. Your brain decides that for you. So whichever way your brain leans, it's important for you to lean into that and just accept that, right? Because you can't buck up against your brain and win. You will lose every time. So if your bar is really high and nothing's really threatening, the good thing for me to do is to learn to be a little bit more cautious, right? Or to maybe use other people's cues for fear and safety, because mine aren't exactly reliable. I could probably get into some dangerous situations that way. But if yours is overactive and you view loud talking, yelling, criticism, verbally abusive or degrading things as threatening, there's nothing that anybody can say to you that's going to make that change for you. Your brain has decided that that's a threat, and you should lean into that, right? Because your brain is always trying to work for your greater good. It's always trying to protect you. And for some reason in your experiences, that situation, a situation where someone was loud or degrading to you, you had cause to be alarmed, and so your brain's trying to warn you, hey, this sounds familiar and this is dangerous, and trying to protect you from it. So all that is to say is, you know, whether or not anybody else agrees that it's traumatic or if anybody else agrees that it's as big a deal as your brain's making it, honor your brain. Honor what's authentic to you, whether it makes sense to other people or not. So the short answer to the question about the chronic abuse in the workplace is that if your brain says it's abusive, do yourself a favor and get out. That's really good self-love and self-care. It's not good for you personally, and so leave that situation. That's a good way to take care of yourself. So the long-term impact of staying in a situation that your amygdala is telling you is bad for you is all the same things with chronic trauma that we've been talking about. It will lead to chronic stress is sort of the same. So it's going to be your central nervous system will be activated. You'll get adrenaline, cortisol, and testosterone in your blood, which isn't good long-term, right? Your heart rate will be elevated, which increases your risk for stroke and heart attack. Your respirations will be more shallow, which over time is going to lead to you constantly being in a state of hyperventilating, which will lead to issues with your lungs. Your digestion slows down, which over time will make you, insulin resistant, and cause the glucose to stay in your blood, which over time leads to diabetes. There are so many health repercussions to being in that chronic state of stress that the responsible and self-loving thing to do is to get yourself out of situations like that. we need to work. Most of us need to work, right? I'm not from old money, and I'm not from new money either. Like, I'm from no money. So, like, I have to work. But I love myself enough to only put myself in situations where I'm valued and appreciated in the workplace. And when I find that that's not true, I make moves to leave the situation. And that's what you should do too. And it doesn't matter if you are a cashier at Walmart or like you're a janitor at a school. It doesn't matter what your job is. If you're being abused there, try to change that job. Because it's not worth all the health repercussions. The way you'll pay for those health care issues over time isn't going to be worth the financial gain of staying there. So I hope I answered that question. If I gave you more questions, let me know. If it's time for me to do an Ask Em Anything or a live so you can ask questions and do this more interactively, I love doing those. Those are so fun for me. So please let me know and I'll set one of those up. I appreciate all your feedback. The feedback's been so great, and I've been so thankful for that. And please give me, I don't know, what you want to hear next. And thanks for tuning in. Don't forget to hit subscribe. Give a shout out to my emotional support kitty Jasper. Actually, this one's Matthew's. I don't know why he's on this side of the camera. I think he's trying to get Matthew to come out here and dance. If you didn't see that little TikTok I made, help me get Matthew to come on this side and talk or dance or something, because he's always behind the scenes. Thank you for tuning in. And again, Emily Ross, LPC. See you next time. Now I sing. Rue, do you want to sing to me? Oh, you come in too. Look at all my kitties. Look at all my pets. All my emotional support pets are here. Where's Dash? Oh, Dash is bossing me around. She's on the director's chair. Are you my emotional support, Rue? Hmm?